Morning, everybody. This is Maseches Bava Kama, Daf Yud Amud Aleph. Yeah. Let's go. Good Chodesh, good week, good everything. Yes. We are holding in the word Velitni. The Gemara asks the following question. Bezos Hashem will be able to get it well. Frek the Gemara. The Gemara asks, Velitni choymer b'shomi bebo, sha'ashor chiev bo yisakelim b'she'enken bebo. When we compared shol to bo, we're now starting to basically, slowly but surely, try and investigate and look into the Braisa and start asking questions, because the Braisa seemed to have missed a few kulas and chumras, some stringencies and leniencies. The Braisa seems to like miss a few of them, and we're curious to know why. So we start by asking, V'litni chomer b'shol mi bebo. Why don't you say that one of the things that shol is more severe than bo, sha'shol chiyev bo yisakelim m'shenken bebo. Yeah? When it came to Eish, we compared Kalim of Eish to Kalim of Bo. By Shol, we didn't. Why didn't we say that by Kalim, a Shol, says Rashi, a Shol that kicked Kalim, he's angry at someone, so he's kicking all the china bowls and all the china things and all the wooden things, or he gores it, is he chayev? Yes. Mashenken the bow. A bow, if Kalim fell inside, the bala bow is potu. Why don't you mention it? Why is the Braisa missing it, especially at the end? It didn't mention it regarding Eish. So why does it miss it regarding Bo and Shol? Answers the Gemara. Must be, oh, Mani. What's Mani? Not Gelt. Oh, Mani, who is it? Who is the author of the Braisa? Must be Rabbi Yehuda. He, the Mechayev Odinske Kelim Bo. We've seen before, Rabbi Yehuda is the one who holds, he learns the Torah differently, the drosha differently, and he says that if Kalim fell into a bar, chayev. Okay, he believes, not regarding Odom, regarding Kalim, he believes that if Kalim fell into the bar, somebody fell into the bar, nothing happened to the person, but all the Kalim, boom, trach, boom, everything fell, broke, chayev. Rabbi Yehuda argues and thinks chayev. Very good, so it makes sense. If so, Shol and Bor are both Chayv and Kalim. That's why we didn't mention it, because this Braisa happens to follow Rabbi Yehuda. Very nice. Is it very nice? No. I already gave you a hint before that this answer, this teretz, is not going to work. Why? Rabbi Yehuda, if you believe this is Rabbi Yehuda, if so, let's go. Let's see if that works or not, or it doesn't work. Ema Seifa, let's look at the end of the Braisa. What does it say there? Choymer be'esh mi bebo. We compare fire to pit, esh to bo. We compare them, and what do we say? Sha'esh dakel elechu lahazik. The fire is more severe, more grave. In what way? The esh walks and, so to speak, spreads and damages as it goes along. And also, umuad lechol ben dover roilo, ben dover shen roilo. Fire eats, fire consumes things that are roi, that are normally yet fed into the fire. Yeah, the fire feeder, like hay, like wood, you're chayev on that, but also dover shen roilo, ma she'en ken bebo. As opposed to a bow, where the fire, there are certain things you're not chayev on fire, en roilo, they're not normally burnable, they don't normally burn, yeah, ma she'en ken bebo, you're chayev on everything. Dover roilo, mai ninu, what are those things that are normally eaten, consumed by the fire, and it's normal? What is it? Mai ninu, what are they? Eitzim, wood, right? Okay, so wood is something that you normally feed your fire with. Firewood, very good. What are those things that a fire does consume but is not suitable for the fire? They won't be your first choice to feed your lag bomber fire. Kalim. Even if they're from wood, by the way, kalim is something that is, yeah, you're not going to take your nice ladle made out of spoon, right, and put it in the fire, nachon? So kalim are not normally fed into the fire, and yet the fire is chayv on it. If fire came into someone's house because of Reuven's negligence, it ate someone's house lo aleinu, including all the plastic spoons and all the, I don't know, things you wouldn't put into the fire, then what? Of course it's chayv. Only in Mashen can be bo, as opposed to bo, where kalim are potter. If your kalim fell into the bore and broke, you're not chayev. Wait a second, it doesn't make sense. Now you're telling me that the author of the Braisa believes that in bo, kalim are not chayev in bo. Wait, Rabbi Yehuda, you just told me it's Rabbi Yehuda. You're not making sense in your answer. Rabbi Yehuda, amat mechayev Rabbi Yehuda, anis kalim bebo, right? Doesn't work. You're telling me Rabbi Yehuda is the author of the Braisa, and that's why at the beginning, when you compared Bol to Shaul, we said, no, they're all Chayv on Kalim. We very elegantly ignored the Kalim business. Oh, we're Rabbi Yehuda now. This is Rabbi Yehuda land. And he believes everything is Kalim, is Chayv everywhere, including Bor. Ah, so how do you explain the Sefer? Didn't the Sefer just tell me otherwise? Didn't the Sefer say regarding Eish, that we have Eish and Bo, we say the Bo is Chayv on everything. Which everything are you talking about, Mr. Kalim? Right? Meaning a Bor is not Chayv on Kalim, and Eish is Chayv on Kalim. So now you're telling me that the Bor is not Chayv on Kalim. How could that be? You said it's Rabbi Yehuda. That's not Rabbi Yehuda. Is it Rabbi Yehuda? Isn't Rabbi Yehuda? What's going on over here? El Olam Rabbanani. Babam. It's Rabbanon. It's Rabbanon. And here we come to a rule. We come to a Yesod, which we learned in Kita Dalit. Really, it's Rabbanon. Now, obviously, the question is, if this is Rabbanon, doesn't make sense. Why? Rabbanon, what do they believe? That if something falls into a bor, and this thing is Kalim, any dishes, any Kalim, any normal things, what about that? What do we say? According to Rabbanon, you're a potter. Okay. Now, according to Rabbanon, if Kalim are potter in the bowl, why did they miss it at the beginning? At the beginning of the Braisa, when we spoke about Shaul versus bowl, you should have told me that Shaul and bowl, there's a Chumra Beshor, that if he kicked or gored the Kalim, he's Chayiv, and bowl is potter. Why did you miss that? It's Rabbanon with a miss. There's some kind of a missed opportunity here at the beginning, something you didn't mention. Answers the Gemara, V'tana V'shiel. The Tana left behind one item. Sometimes the Braisa or even the Mishnah, they don't mention everything. When they give you a whole list of things, unless there's a number, there's no number here. There's no number. If it says 4, 5, 6, it means this and that's it. Here the Braisa started very, very, you know, wishy-washy without saying any particular number, very general. And therefore, it's the Bryce's right, so to speak, not to mention everything. Yeah, I'll ask you now how many states, you know all the states of the United States, right? So I'll tell you, give me names of the United States. Well, we're going to start saying, I don't know, Iowa, Idaho, North Carolina. Yeah, you're not going to say all 50. We don't have time, right? So you'll mention a few of them, and then we'll go on. The Mishnah or the Bryce, so don't mention each and every example. They just mention a few, and sometimes they miss one. Problem is, the Bryce never misses Rakrega. The Bryce never misses, or Mishnah never misses one item, unless it misses two items. That's always the rule. In other words, either you don't miss anything, either you say the entire list, or you leave behind at least two. You never leave behind only one item of the list. That's the rule of the Braisa. I'm not sure why, actually. That's the way, unfortunately, since age of 10 till today, I don't remember, maybe I've seen once. I don't remember exactly the reason. Could be that if you miss one, it shows Kilo you're Dafka against it. If you miss two, then you say Lav Dafka. If you mention all 50 states of America, you're going to say to me in 1 minute, blah, 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 everything from, I don't know, Alabama till, I don't know what, yeah, till Wisconsin, I don't know. You'll mention all of them together and you'll miss one state. That means you have something against this state. You think Hawaii should be independent or something. Yeah, but if you just miss two countries, two states, it means better. You're not talking about everything. No questions for the next 1 minute. And therefore, the question now is, look carefully at the words, my shir dehai shir. Which other item did it leave behind dehai shir that allowed it to leave behind l'shayer, shrayim, to leave behind the other one? Yeah, you can't leave behind one, either at least two or zero. Which is the other mysterious nikuda here, the tichuna you missed behind that allowed you also to miss the Kalim in the boar, and says, Gmar Shir Tomun. Tomun! How did you forget about Mr. Tomun? He's such a nice guy. Tomun, who's Tomun? Tomun means what? Hatmono on Shabbos. You know about that. And we also know about Tomun in Bo. Not in Bo. Tomun in Eish. Tomun means what? Hidden, covered. Let's say somebody kept his $1 million in a bag, and the bag, he left it in the barn. The barn is what? Has haystacks in the barn, and he left his $1 million bag over there. It's a safe place away from everybody else. So then the fire burnt the thing, the $1 million. By the way, I'm not sure it's a good example. Could be it's a machlokes. Not everything. Could be money. It's a shaila. I'm just giving an example. Now, please don't get hooked up to my examples. Bekitzer, begadol, if someone's fire burnt someone's good, they were hidden. Yeah, they were sort of covered, hidden, closed in a bag in the field, let's say, is not chayv on that. It says, oi hagodish, oi hakama. Kama means the cereals as they are, whatever, the stalks as they are standing, come. Not if it's hidden. Just a come is uncovered, exposed, so to anything exposed, you have an ish. So this is something the Braisa missed. I don't know why, but it missed it because the other two, both bow and show, Rashi points out, let's say show starts goring a bag. He doesn't know what's in the bag. He thinks it's a punching bag. The bull psychologist told him it's very good to gore a punching bag, but that bag happened to have inside a very expensive, Swarovski dishes, yeah? So then is the show chayev, the show's owner? Yes, because only on fire, we give an exemption to potomun. What about bull? Now, bull is potter from Kalim anyways. So says Rashi, let's say someone's sack full of wheat. Someone's sack full of tomatoes fell into the bowl. He was tamun. He was covered. It was stored in a bag. And yet, you chayv on that, Tosfos argues. But Rashi believes that foods are not lekelim, and therefore you chayv on them. In any event, tamun is something that we missed. We know it's true. Nobody argues on it. But the Braisa missed both tamun, and therefore it also allows it to miss the idea of kelim bebol. We know that show is chayev if he gored the or kicked the kelim. The bow is potu like rabbanon. We chose not to mention it. There's a statement that the Gemara says many times. V'chitana ruchlehu v'lezim is a tana like a merchant in the market, like a peddler that screams. I went on Friday with Masad to the Merkaz, and there was a guy screaming, for the fruit and vegetables, announcing the schar. Masad felt very excited, and he says, it feels like Machne Yehuda over here. He's never been to Machne Yehuda in his life. It is very adult with the descriptions. I feel like I'm in Machne Yehuda. Bekitzer, so the Braisa and the Mishnah are not Machne Yehuda, and therefore, they don't have to basically tell you the whole display. They sometimes hide one or two items, and you go figure it yourself from other Braisas, other Mishnahs, v'chule, v'chule. It's question time. Yeah, commercials for Machne Yehuda. Yeah, go. Jeffrey suggesting that maybe if the Braisa mission would have missed one, I would have thought it's a mistake. Because maybe the Tana, sometimes you can have a choser or something went wrong. But two is too much to make a mistake. Yeah, the Braisa wouldn't have made a mistake on two things. So maybe that's a reason. Could very well be. Interesting idea. I don't know if that's a real thing, but I hear it as a very interesting possible idea. Yes, I'm listening. Let's continue. Iboy Seima, another potential answer, another possible answer. Iboy Seima over here. Iboy Seima, another explanation to the stira. Remember what we said in the Gemara? In the Braisa, let's repeat the question now. Go back one step back. Let's take one step backwards and say what? What was the problem in the Braisa? At the beginning of the Braisa, we ignored the fact that Kalim in a bowl are potter, right? We didn't talk about it. And then when it came to Eish, then we did talk about it. When it came to Eish, we said, look, Eish is chayv on everything and anything, including Kalim, while Bor is not chayv on Kalim. So there was a stira. We said, no, it's not a stira. Rabbanan missed that one point. Rabbanan tana v'shir. Okay. Iboy Seima comes another potential answer. Lolam Rabbi Yehuda, back to square one. Really, this Braisa is Rabbi Yehuda. And Rabbi Yehuda believes that Kelim Midbor are Chayev. He missed it at the beginning, not because he sort of didn't mention because he's not in Machne Yehuda. No, he deliberately does not believe that Kelim are Potter in Bo. He believes Bo is Chayev on Kelim. Oh, Hashem. If so, how did he face the Seifa? Why did he miss it in the Seifa? What did he mention? Why did he say something wrong in the Seifa? How come in the Seifa we say that a fire is Chayev on Kelim? Well, Bo is not Chayev on Kelim. That's downright wrong, according to Rabbi Yehuda. It's not about missing or shmissing. How can Rabbi Yehuda say such things that Eish is chayv on kelim, while Bor is not chayv on kelim? Rabbi Yehuda says Bor is chayv on kelim. What's going on? Answers the Gemara, and this is a lesson for us: how medayik we have to be in the words. Lalam Rabbi Yehuda, v'dolos she'en roi lo. The Braisa never said kelim. It was your interpretation. The Braisa says dolos she'en roi lo. things that are not suitable for fire. That's a very big definition. Lav la to a kelim. This is not coming to talk about kelim to include kelim. Kelim are out of the story according to Rabbi Yehuda, meaning you always chayev. Ela la tuye lichecha niroi v'sichsecha avonov. When we say a fire is chayev on everything, that means something we mentioned before, by the way, a few days ago. If it lichecha, it basically like licked the ground, the nir, the furrows, v'sichsecha avonov. It basically burnt the stones without really burning them. It blackened them, which means even things that the fire did not completely consume, the fire doesn't consume the ground. It's not like the entire earth is going to burn now. We have the whole ball that we live in, yeah, and that's the sphere. No, but what does it do? If you burn someone's field, the land becomes scorched, becomes damaged. As I say, burnt land, right? Burnt, yeah. So then that's not good. Or if someone's wall becomes, you know, is on fire. If someone's wall is on fire, the wall doesn't burn. You know, the stone wall, stones are not really combustibles. LMI, the stone gets black and you need to repaint it. Those things, the fire is chayv on. Those things, the fire is chayv, as opposed to by bol. By bol, there's no such thing. Says Rashi over here, says Rashi that, beish, okay. Says Rashi about the tomun, the bol is no such thing. By bol, not everything you chayv, right? Even according to Rabbi Yehuda, there are certain realities. The truth is, when I come to think of it, according to Rabbi Yehuda, what do we say? That really this is Rabbi Yehuda. Something here doesn't make sense to me. Now it's coming back to me with difficulty. Because we say by fire, it's chayv on everything. Nachon? It's chayv on even the land, even the wall. Even if it doesn't really burn it, but it damaged it, the fire is chayv. As opposed to bo? A bo, he says, is chayv on, not on everything. Bor is not chayv on everything, but the question is, according to Rabbi Yehuda, why is Bor not chayv on everything? Rabbi Yehuda is mechayv on kelim. Is mechayv on kelim, is not mechayv on people. The only thing that Rabbi Yehuda is not mechayv is on people. There's one item Rabbi Yehuda is not mechayv, that is if a person fell into the pit, then he agrees to Rabbanan, then the person, I'm potter if a person was niftu, died over there. Tosfos brings down, what is the equivalent of lichecha niroi v'sichsecha avonov by bo? Tosfos interpreting Rashi says, by bo is just not shayach. Yeah, by bo, there is no such thing of the stones or the earth. The bo doesn't move and doesn't start damaging land or damaging a stone wall that stand upright. There's no such thing. And therefore, we say that by bo, it's just impossible, not shaykh, not in the story. While by esh, the esh is chayv on that. Okay, that's one workable shot. Fine. Now, and of course, all damage, no question. Now, maskif lo avashi. Frag de gemara, Ravashi is now attacking. Yeah. This maskafta is going to be a combination of two questions. Lit nichomer b'shor mi bebo. I have another suggestion. I have another idea. Another question of something that's missing over here. Why don't you write that shor is more severe than bo, more stringent than bo in the following way? Shashor chiev bo shor psule mukdoshin, mashen ken bebo. Oh. Here we have to see Rashi, but first I'll tell you in general the question. The question is as follows. There is a concept called Shor Psulei HaMukdoshin. What's Psulei HaMukdoshin? I'll ask you a question. What happens if you were makdish an animal to Beis HaMikdash, designated an animal to Beis HaMikdash, because you want to bring a korban for whichever reason? Yeah, let's say it's korban oilo. Stam, you want to bring an oilo to Hashem. Very nice, because you had a hero of Era, you have to bring an oilo. Yeah. So now the question is, at some point, the oiler, what happened to the oiler? So all of a sudden, there's a mum, a blemish in the animal. What do you do then? It is disqualified. So what do you do with it? You throw it in garbage? Delete? What? And what does the Gizra do with it? Oh, and not exactly sells it. You close. What? No. Kippah's only chatas. No, not kippah. No. And even not every chatas. What? No. And the winner is Tzvi. He just got a trip to Hawaii. Basically, you're almost there. You do pidyon, not mamish selling, and soon we'll see the difference. The person who has that animal, basically now it's possible. Yeah, you now transfer it to another animal. Yeah, or to money. and then with the money you buy another animal, and now the animal is kedusha free. It's not automatically free of kedusha just because it has a blemish. You have to remove the kedusha by redeeming it on something else. That's all masechta called tmura, a very hard masechta. Now the animal is not kodesh anymore, almost. That's why I resist a little bit the sell. When an animal, he had kedusha, has history of kedusha, and the kedusha was removed, it's not an animal for Beis HaMikdash anymore. He can't bring it as a korban, but the kedusha sort of lingers. For certain things, the kedusha is still there, and you cannot do whatever you want with that animal. That animal still has a certain level of kedusha, and we'll learn it from the Torah, soon we'll see it inside Rashi. For example, you cannot enjoy, if it's a sheep, let's say, you can't enjoy its wool. You can't start shearing it and enjoy the wool. That wool would go to Ekdish, I think, I don't know all the details. You cannot just shear it. Yeah, you don't have sheer joy. Excuse me. Beginning of the week. And what else? You can't just do anything with it. You can't enjoy the milk. If it's a cow, the milk, I guess, goes to Beis HaMikdash. I know it's painful for the cow. Don't know exactly. You can shecht it and eat it. ASAP, just eat it. Don't beat it, eat it. Yeah, that's what you're supposed to do. And almost nothing else. You can sell it in certain ways. It's not completely yours. It's yours, it's chulin, but it is limited. And therefore, once, I'm repeating the Gemara, lit nichoma b'shomi bebo, shashol chia b'shol psulam kedoshin. By shol, the word that the Torah uses is re'ehu, his friend, your fellow Jew. If your shol gored the shol of a fellow Jew, you chayev. Psulam kedoshin belongs to a fellow Jew. That shol that was kodosh and still has some kedusha lingering in it, yeah, stays behind, belongs to Shmerel Beryl, and therefore chayev. Masha'en ken bebo, a bow. By bo, there's a drasha, which we'll see in Rashi. The drasha is that by bo, you're not chayv and psulam kedoshin. If a bull that belongs to Shmerel, and Shmerel walked around the street with a bull that has blemish in it, and was kodesh, but is still a little bit kodesh, so to speak, there's a drasha brought down in Rashi that says that on that, the bo is not chayv. A shor is chayv on that kind of specific behema, and the bull is not chayv on that. Okay? So why don't you bring it down? Why don't you mention it in the brisa? How come you miss it? I'm not reading Rashi now because I don't want to kill the momentum. Now, you, according to Rabbanon, it's not difficult. Let's see it in the Gemara. E omad bishlam Rabbanon he, if you say the brisa is according to Rabbanon, I did the shayer hach, shayer nami hach. Which means Rabbanan, we already decided that this brisa is officially incomplete. The incomplete list of nezikin, of differences of nezikin, no question. Mimela, okay, here's another one to the list of exceptions to the rule. Here's one more. We already have Tomun, right? Together with Tomun, we have the Kalim in the bowl. Center, the more the merrier. You have a third one, which is less common even, and that is the show psulam kedoshin eli amato biuda, but according to biuda ha mai shir dai shir, according to biuda you can't leave one behind. According to biuda the Mishnah did deal with everything, right? Because he believes that kelim just doesn't exist, so the Mishnah dealt with everything. Hey, so now the only one, the odd one out, the one that's left behind, is one item only called what? The show psulam kedoshin. Hey, that's too little. You can't have one out of the list. It's not fair. Yeah, only one kid out of the group, that's not nice, right? So how can you explain the Mishnah according to Rabbi, the Raisa? And the Gemara attempts to answer, but we'll quickly go back on it. Says the Raisa, answers the Gemara, excuse me, Shir Dash Beniroi. Dash Beniroi is a very, very interesting thing. Says Rashi, let's say Shaw was threshing over was stepping all over as if it's threshing the wheat, and it did it over a person's nir. Nir is the furrow, the nice furrow. Finally, you got the furrow so nice and straight and clean. And then his show comes, and he maliciously, Dafka, steps all over it to ruin the furrow. Very interesting animal psychology over here. Look at Rashi. I'm skipping the Rashi. I wanted to tell you. I'll read it to you later. Rashi, which is basically 3-4 lines above where we are, Dira Maskel Dash Beniroi, tells us about the animal psychology. Shim Dash Shoh Beniroi Veniskavin Lekach. Let's say the show is walking over your pharaoh. Now it's destroying the pharaoh because it's walking and it's basically stamping. And again, it's making it flat and even with the ground. Shareshvon Mulubodin Bedisha. He knows what he's doing. He knows how to do Disha and he's aware of it, so it's Keren. He's doing it on purpose. Yeah, told the Kohen he should come and also Lazik. It's not walking there innocently. By the way, you notice that this entire Brisa talks about Keren, not about Shen V'Regel. So this Shaul is very upset with someone, with his Bailim, with the owner of the field, and he's destroying on purpose the Nir. He has to pay the Nir, there was Mekalkel, he has to pay. The owner of the Shaul, pay me. Half or whole, depends what kind of Shaul. Pay for that destruction that he caused. Mashenken bebo, the lo shach bezekarka. A bo, says Rashi, like Tosfos brought down before, there's no near by bo. There's no such thing. A bo can never ruin the karka. You can say that when you dug the bo, it ruined the karka, but the bo itself is not ruining more karka. There's no such thing. Yeah? So mimeila, here we have one more item to the list that was conveniently forgotten, and that is dash beniroi. It only applies to shol, doesn't apply to bo, and therefore we forgot about it. And on purpose, and also we forgot about the other one, the one of Shaul Psula Mukdoshin. Frag the Gemara, no, I don't accept it, says the Gemara. Is that an answer you're giving me? Lam Shiu, that's not called leaving it behind. The Atana, Shikendako Lelechul Azik. Wrong. When you mention the Shaul that he walks around and does Nezik, and you mean what? Here we mean Keren. So it's included. I don't care if it's walking ferociously in someone's house, breaking all the china, or if he walks in someone's field and destroyed the pharaohs. It's all the same thing. It is included. It is included. Dash Biniro is just one example of the behavior of a shaul that walks around in a way that's mazik everything. And therefore, Rabbi Yehuda seems not to be the author of the Braisa. Again, let's review. According to Rabbanon, this Braisa is an incomplete Braisa. Let me make my blessing. According to Rabbanon, the Braisa missed two items, and that's okay. It's absolutely fine. If you miss two items, you're good. It's a good Braisa, good Mishnah. Which items did we miss? Tomun, the fact that fire is chayav, that's butter on anything hidden, while other things are chayav. And also we missed kelim and bo. We missed the kelim and bo as opposed to shor. Chayav and kelim, bo is butter and kelim. We're absolutely cool, calm, and calculated about it. Mashenken, according to Rabbi Yehuda, we are in trouble deep. According to Rabbi Yehuda, we wanted to say that the Braisa is Rabbi Yehuda, and the Braisa missed kelim because Rabbi Yehuda believes that kelim are chayav in bo. Bo is chayav and kelim. And therefore, maybe it's Rabbi Yehuda, and we missed kelim because Rabbi Yehuda doesn't believe kelim in chayav on. But then we said no, because according to Rabbi Yehuda, you're also missing an item. Missing an item called which one? Shaul Psula Mukdoshin. Bishlam of Yerabonon, you already have three Yerabonon, there are three items missing. Sorry, not two. Forgot the Maskana. If you're Rabbanon, you have three items missing, and that's fine. Rabbanon are good. You're missing Tomun, you're missing Kelim and Bo, and Shaul Psula and Mukdoshin. The Shaul that is half Kodosh, and you're not Chayv in Bo, you Chayv in Shaul, is fine. No problem. If you're Rabbi Yehuda, you're only missing one item, Shaul Psula and Mukdoshin. The other items are not missing. He doesn't believe that they're right. And therefore, it's a problem. Because according to Rabbi Yehuda, and Kazadavar, according to Rabbi Yehuda, you can't have a Braisa missing one item. Let us read the Rashi that I was telling you about before. Rashi is bringing us the Psukim. Shaul Psula Mukdoshin. This Rashi, Shaul Psula Mukdoshin, is in is above where the Gemara is of the equivalent Gemara. Shaul Psula Mukdoshin. Yeah. Says Rashi, you have it, it's about from the top of narrow lines, you take, I don't know, 15 or so lines. Shaul Psula Mukdoshin. Maybe the line starts with Mukdoshin. Shenifda. The Shaul was redeemed. The Kedusha was redeemed. V'nafil bebo. You know, happened a day later, or a week later, or a month later. It fell into a pit. It's off Beis HaMikdash. Yeah, goes into the pit now by mistake. Potu balabo. Even if the Shaul died, the owner of the pit is potu. He doesn't have to pay for the owner of that holy Shaul. Why not? Dichtiv Baal HaBor Yishalem V'Ameis Yeloi. The Baal HaBor Yishalem, the Baal HaBor will pay, and the dead corpse would belong to him, to the owner of the show. There's a question about show, Bo, who owns it? Lamaisa, somebody owns the cadaver, owns the cadaver, how do you pronounce it? Whatever, the cadaver, what? Cadaver, abracadabra, the cadaver. Then what? Then, Beseda, very nice. Then, Yotzazeh, this is excluded, she'enamei shaloi. A dead body of a psula mukdoshin does not belong to the owner. Why? The Afel gav the Nifda, even though this animal was redeemed and the Kedusha is almost off the animal. If he died, you're not allowed to feed it to the dogs or sell it to a goy. You can't do anything with an Avela, which is Hana, because it's only meant for consumption, human consumption with Shechita. That's almost, if I think, the only thing that it, you can do that. Kedamrinan, as we say, it says, B'bchoyos Tizbach, it says, Tizbach ve'ochalta, Tizbach, the word Tizbach, you should shecht. Regarding this animal, it says, Tizbach, slaughter it, ve'loi giza, and don't shear it. Yeah, you're not allowed to shear it. Now, boso, v'loi cholov, you're allowed to enjoy the meat, but not the milk. Not because it's meat and milk together. Yeah? You can't milk that cow or that sheep because it's not part of the minimal consumption of meat. V'ochalta, v'loi leklovecha. You should eat it, and not Rexy and not Kingi. Your animals, they can't eat it, only you. You can't benefit from the nevela. Very nice. U'b'psula mukdoshin, the kosuv mendaber. Talk to psula mukdoshin. Aha. So if psula mukdoshin is something that I cannot benefit from the dead corpse, mimela, bo doesn't apply there. Because the boar talks about something which I can enjoy. So obviously, bo, gzeras kosuv. I don't know why. Kach, Hashem wanted. God l'chomos is borach. That the boar is potter psula mukdoshin. On the other hand, by show, here comes the chumrah. Let's say that same bull, which is like, you know, 50% kadosh, goes out there and another bull starts goring it. What happens then? The owner of the other bull is chayev for his show, goring the holy show. Why is that? Like I told you, it is the show of his friend. I'll stop here. Because later is whatever, they'll stop here. The shor'eu, it's shor'eu. The animal does belong to one person and is allowed to enjoy the flesh. Yeah, one big bull, you can eat a lot of, you know, yom tovi meal, freeze it. Yeah, mimela, that regarding shor, you're chayev, regarding bor, you're potter. So why did the b'risa miss it? According to Rabbanon, we are covered, because this b'risa is not in Machne Yuda. This b'risa is Tanev Ashiya. It talks about most characteristics of Nezek, except for three, and that's absolutely cool and fine. Thank you very much. Yes, let's continue with questions. Shalti b'miktsas nizkoi. Now we're in the two dots. Yeah, now the two dots. Yeshavti mikzas nizkoi. Yudah modal. What become Yudah modal of two dots? Two dots zehut. Yeshavti mikzas nizkoi. Basically, this from now on, the Gemara is going to discuss the Mishnah, the line in the Mishnah that said, it said in the Mishnah, Kol shechavti echshavti b'miktsas nizkoi, chavti b'tashlumo nizkoi, kehechsher kol nizkoi. If I was machshir, what does machshir mean in Hebrew? To enable, to make something kosher, proper to be used, or proper to be damaging. Yeah. If I created part of the damage, if I'm the one who enabled the damaging party to really damage, and before I came, the damage was not possible, I'm an accomplice, even a relatively small accomplice in the Nezek, still we blame the entire Nezek on me. There is such a case, a very specific case, in which if the person is helping the Nezek to happen, then the entire blame falls on him. The question is, where does that happen? The Gemara is going to bring us all kinds of cases where you have accomplice in crime. For example, in Amud Beis, I don't know if it will be today, there's a case of, let's say, Lo Aleinu Chas V'Shalom, a person meets a gang of 10 people, and they all beat him up, one after the other. And but the ninth person is already very, very weak, but the 10th person is the one who actually killed him. There's a question. Yeah, he's the 10th one Chayev, because he's the one who did the Makim B'Patish, the final blow, Kipshutoi, or Lol Chayev. Because the blow of the 10th one wouldn't be so lethal unless the ones before already, right, debilitated him. So that's a question. Here too, we're going to discuss Bo. That's going to, okay, I'm already giving you a bit of the answer. The real example which will follow through is going to be a Bo of 9th Fochim that later on was turned into a Bo of 10th Fochim, and that completely changed the Bo's status. Let's see. Tono Bonon. Yeah, Tono Bonon. Ichshalti miktas nizkoi. Chavti b'teshlumei nizkoi. If I was machshir miktsas nizkoi, I enabled a little bit of the nezek. I only added the tip of the iceberg, the tip of the thing to the nezik. I topped it or lowered it, and I just added a little bit to make it into a more mazik thing. Chavti b'deshlum nizkoi. When it comes to the payment, I have to pay kehechsher kol nizkoi, as if I caused the entire thing to happen. Interesting. Ketzad, how is that? How is that possible? Give me a case. Says Braisa, achoyfil bo tisha. Achoyfil bo tisha. Excuse me, I'm going to see over here. Yeah. Achoyfil bo tisha. A person dug a bow of nine. Reuven and Shimon are good old friends. Reuven dug a bow of nine tfochim. What's the halacha regarding a bow of nine tfochim? You remember from a few days ago? Not chayv at all, or you're not chayv except for nezikin. If the animal was damaged by a bow of nine, I'm chayv. If it died, I'm not chayv. Chachomi made that very clear dichotomy between 10 or less or more than 10. 10 is a cutoff point. By 9 tfochim, between I think 3 and 9, the animal is damaged, we allege it to you, the Baal HaBow. We can ask why, and the bow, again, this whole parak is just a kedoma for the Olma Sechta. Everything will be discussed more. But generally speaking, 9 tfochim, we're learning from different ideas, Chavoto, Avira, we'll see. 9 tfochim is what causes nezik, and we allege the nezik to the bow. But if it's if it died with 9 tfochim, if an animal fell into a bow of 9 tfochim and he died over there, butter. Okay, we don't connect the animal to the bow of 9 tfochim. You can ask about a little poodle dog, I don't know. The Braisa there starts measuring the show. We'll see that later, but let's just accept it now as an axiom. Now, the person, what did he do? One person who went dug a bor of nine, which is called bor lenezikin, but not lamisa. Another person, Shimon, came and dug one more tefach, and he crossed the red line now, not the Red Sea, the red line, by doing a sort for him. Now that bor is lethal. Achron chayev. The achron is chayev for everything. Unbelievable. Chachomim say, from Misa, the last one is chayev, because now the shore died because of the 10th tefach. The 9th tefachim, says Reuven, correctly, I am not chayev for Misa. If it would only be my bow, then the 10th one won't be able to be there. You don't have 10 without 9, true. But 9 alone wouldn't cause anything regarding Misa. But not only that, not only Rabbanan say that the person on Misa is chayv, the second one is chayv for creating a bor of 10 tfachim, which is killing a lidl. Not only that, even for nezikin, they learn from psukim. They learn it from psukim, and they say en koire achar koire ki chayish en koire achar koire, which means the person that the last one, or maybe it's a different drosh. I'm not sure exactly what the drosh is. I don't understand saying. The Rabbanan say the last one that is the Koya, the last one that crossed from 9 to 10, he crossed the divide, he's the one who's chayv on everything. Both Nezikin and even Ezikin. Even Ezikin and Misa. Wow. You can ask why. It's a good question. How we're getting the ninth guy, the first guy of the nine, he did the first 9 yards. Yeah, the ninth, he goes all 9 yards, but only 9 tfachim. So he's potter, otherwise he would be chayim. If you cross from 9 to 10, it's ki'ilu, we view it in lomdus, is a whole new bow. It changed from bor one to bor b, bor a to bor b. Bor b is like all new creation. You can argue, you can ask, which is fine, and we'll get to the actual sugya and daf. Nun Aleph, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, let's concede over there. But basically, that's what Rabbanon say. Yeah, that's what Rabbanon say. Yeah. Bor Tisha, L'shalom Asor, Achron Chayev, always. Okay, Rabbanon say, sorry, L'havi Kor, Achron Kor, that's what I thought, yeah. Rabbanon say, they learn from a Pasuk, not En Kor, Achron Kor, sorry, I was wrong. L'havi Kor, Achron Kor, they learn from the Pesukim Medrosho, from extra words over there, it says Yiftach Yichre. It comes to tell me an extra pasuk that the last one, he's the one that's chayv. However, I just want to point out something. The Tosfos points over there. If one dug 10 and another one came and dug further 11 or 20, then he's not chayv, the second one. Only the one who crossed from 9 to 10, that's a very, very, very important cross from one status to another status. You basically change the status of the boar from Nezikin to Misa. It's a whole new boar you created. If another guy came afterwards and changed it from 10, dug deeper into 15, he's only adding on you, and then there's a question if they do it together or whatever. That's all Shaila. But the one who's only Chayiv, even though he's the second one, and he has the exclusivity, the big covered exclusivity over Nezikin, is the one who changed from 9 to 10. That's a Rabbanan view. Let's just for now accept it as it is. Maybe tomorrow I'll bring more Mefarshim, but that's the way we see it now. So now, the Deloy Kerebi. Now, by the way, our Mishnah now works very well according to Rabbanon. What did the Mishnah just say? Beautiful. The Mishnah said, if I added a little bit of Nezek, one Tefach, one out of ten, one teeny, what did I do? Teeny peeny, one Tefach. And then, nevertheless, Chayv B'Tushlom Nizkoy, Ke'ilu Ke'echshur Kol Nizkoy. I'm Chayv the entire Nezek. It's as if the whole new Nezek came to the world, wasn't there ever before. It's a whole new reality, even though it's the same person, a whole new Zach. From 9 to 10, he's Chayv. That works very well with our Mishnah. So our Mishnah follows Rabbanon. Well, what does it mean it follows Rabbanon as opposed to who? V'deloike Rebbe, unlike Rebbe, as opposed to Rebbe, the Tanya, it says in the Raisa, Achoyfer bo tisho, ubrache v'shim laso. Somebody dug a bore of 9, somebody else came and completed it to 10. Achron Chayv on everything. Say Rabbanon. Rabbanon are our people over here. Rebbe Omer no. Achar Arachon Lamisa. When it comes to death, then we say, of course, the second one is Chayev. Because if not for the second one, there wouldn't be Misa. There would be Nezikin, but not Misa. Achar Shneim LeNizokin. When it comes to Nezokin, they're both, yeah, partners in crime. If the boar of 10 caused Nezek, Nezek would have happened anyway by 9 too. And Lamai, there's 10. Who cares? At the end of the day, 9 Tfachim, 10 Tfachim, both cause Nezik. 10 causes worse, but also Nezik. So Rebbe says, logically, excuse me, he doesn't believe that Pasuk comes to tell me that extra drosha. He remains with pure logic. Logically speaking, well, Nezikin, Nezikin, we beat 9, beat 10, Nezikin is all the same. Rabbi Omar, that's how we learn the Braisa. The Mishnah, excuse me, to follow Rabbanon. Rabbi Omar, the Misa, V'divrei HaKol. Rabbi says, no, we're talking about Misa, and that follows everyone's opinion. Meaning, let's say the person dug a 10th tefach, and what happened to the animal? The animal died, wasn't injured, it properly died. Then what happens? Everyone agrees, both Rabbanon and Rebbe, they both agree, because I'm the one who caused Misa. I brought the Misa factor, and the first guy, Reuven, did not bring the Misa factor. Therefore, me, let's call me Shimon, I'm Chayev. Everyone agrees to that. The only machlok is about Nezikin. If Nezikin occurred in the 10th Fochim Bor, what do we say? Rabbanan say we still blame the second guy. He created a whole new bow. Forget about the first guy. The Sheinken. See, Rebbe says, no, Nezikin. Nezikin could happen also with the first guy, but 9th Fochim, and therefore they're both Chayev. Okay, so our Mishnah follows either Rabbanon with Nezikin or follows everyone with Misa. Yes? Some say a similar idea in different words. Lema, some say that the Gemara said the same content with a different approach. Lema deloy kerebi. Let us say, the Gemara suggested, are you saying Lema? Shall we say that our Mishnah is not according to Rebbe? Meaning, our Mishnah that said that only the second guy is Chayev and not the first one. The first one is off the hook, scot-free, and only the second one is Chayev. Is that Lichor, it's not like Rebbe, because Rebbe said that they're both Chayev in Ezekin. No. Our Mishnah can survive Rebbe. Our Mishnah could fit into Rebbe. And what does our Mishnah say? Mishnah talks about Misa, about death. Everyone agrees, when it comes to death, only the second guy is Chayev, not the first one. That's, because only the second one caused death and not the first one. Even though the first one also was machshirit, and you can ask a question which is legitimate, I don't know why. The guy of 9 also caused a lot, but still, the breaking point, so to speak, the cutoff point, is what we care about, l'kulam when it comes to Misa. Before, there was no Misa bar, you made it into a Misa kind of bar, you're chayv, and everyone agrees to that. Now comes the Gemara with other atkaftos, other questions, other attacks. Maskif lo mizera v'tu leka. Are you sure? Don't you have any other case except for your favorite boar over here of 9 and 10? Is there another case of somebody helping an ezek happen and he should be chayv on the whole story? Isn't there such a case? Vayika, look, I have a brisa that says the same. Masal shor lechamisha bnei odom. A person gave his show to five people to guard. Oh, he knows his chayra. That shor is a Spanish kind of show. You know, he likes running around and goring everybody. He needs, let's assume now, he needs five people to guard him. Guard him, no less than that. Upasha ba'echad men. One of them was Pasha. One of them had his tequila in the corner and ignored the shor that was going crazy. One of them did not do the shmira, the hizik. Sure enough, the show was not properly guarded, went ahead and was mazik, he started kicking or thing doing stuff. Chayev, that fifth guy is chayev. Frag the Gemara, wait a second, well, what's the story exactly? Echidami, what exactly is the story? Ilema, if you want to tell me, look, I portrayed the case, the belav iu loy have a mintar, if we know clearly that without the presence of the fifth person, Reuven, Shimon, Levi, Yehuda, Yisachar, let's say Yisachar, we know that Yisachar is instrumental and necessary, like everybody else, without five people, there's no Shmira. Pshita, of course, then what's the Chiddush? Diyu Kovid, of course he caused the entire Nezik. They all started together, and he moved the Shmira. It's like you have five doors, and the bull can run away from any of those five doors. If you open one door, of course you chayev, yeah? Because it's key, everyone has exclusive responsibility. Then avada, what's the chiddush? You don't have to, it's not even chiddush in the Mishnah, for the Mishnah to tell me. Ela de belaviyu nami mintal. You want to tell me that without him, there would be Shmira? Then my COVID, what do you want from him? If without Yisachar, there would be good Shmira. Yisachar is just a nice extra, but really without him, the shore should have normally be guarded. So his presence is not ayayay. It doesn't make a big difference. What did he do? In other words, it's very hard to find a case where a person does a little bit and he's chayv on everything. So far, we only find it in a bowl. Bowl is the big chiddush. Because bowl, we ignore the guy who created nine. I think it's a chiddush, and that's good for what we're looking for. We're looking for chiddushim. We want the Mishnah to tell me something weird, something new, something I didn't know before, something I wouldn't have thought about. We really get the first guy of nine tefachim off the hook and only get the second guy, we get him on the hot seat and ignore the first guy, and that's a big chiddush. That's a chiddush we're looking for. But the case of the five guys together, if one of them got out of his sleeping on the helm, as they say, then, and he just didn't guard, then of course he's chayev. Because it's clearly that with him there would be Shmira, without him there would be no Shmira. Then Allah is Chayev. Matzkif Rav Sheshes. Now Rav Sheshes is asking more. The ho ika malbi b'chavila. Malbi b'chavila means what? A person created fire. He has nice, let's assume he has nice coals in his backyard at the end of the festival of Lag Baomer. And now somebody else, a big chochem, came and added many chavilot, basically parcels, basically a whole stack of wood, of hay, wood on top of that, and made the fire bigger and therefore more approachable and was going to spread into the friend's field. Then again, Echidami, what's the story? You want to tell me the second one is Chayev? It's also a case of accomplice in crime. You want to fit that into the Mishnah? Daf Yud Amud Beis. Again, the same story. If you say that without his interference, the fire would have gone, the fire would have died, the fire would be just coals, would eventually die, like we spoke about a few days ago, and he mamish created from coal, he created a flame, a proper fire, pshita, avada, then of course he's chayv, the second guy, because beforehand there was nothing. Elad will love you azla. If you want to tell me that without him the fire would have gone anyways, the first guy was negligent and the second guy only made it a little bit quicker, but his interference was not really clearly, didn't make a difference. My COVID, what did he do? Again, the question is, you didn't yet find a case where the first guy is completely potter, the first guy is completely chayv, without seemingly having any logic. All the other cases are poshut either way. It's not a chiddush for a Mishnah. Maskif for a Papa, and we'll finish here. Let's just start with a question, interesting question. There'll be a longer one. We'll leave it for tomorrow. Let's just get a taste of tomorrow coming soon. There's another braisa that you should have mentioned and connected to our Mishnah. Five people were sitting on a bench, they did not break it. The sixth guy came, and he broke the whole thing. The last one is chayev, not the first one. There seems to be like, and it was not fatter necessarily. They're all nice and slim. They're all 120 kilos. The last guy is the one who caused it, and his chayev seems to be similar to our case. We'll see tomorrow what the answer is. Thank you very much, beautiful. Thank you very much.